So hopefully it is. So I'm going to right now talk about the probate process. Believe it or not, the probate process in New Jersey is relatively easy. It's not easy this very moment because the surrogate's offices are closed, but typically all that the executor of the will needs to do is bring the original will, death certificate, and check for about $150 to the county surrogate's office. See, and they meet with the surrogate. The surrogate then says, okay, looks, I see that it's what's called a self-proving will, and here's your papers. Sometimes other documents are not self-proving wills. Sometimes they're not properly signed. So think of the surrogate as a fancy name for the will clerk. If they don't accept it, someone has to spend, $3,000-$4,000 spending time, hiring an attorney, going to court, and doing a lot of work. So there was the old way of wills was person signs and then there's two witnesses, and then one of the two witnesses had to go to the surrogate's office and sign paperwork. Well, that became cumbersome because sometimes you couldn't find the witnesses. So there was a change in the law to say that if the person signs, then there's two witnesses, then there's an attorney or notary, then the person signs again, and there's language that we take from the self-proving will statute, the two witnesses sign again, then the attorney or notary signs again, and therefore it dispenses with the requirement of finding witnesses. So it's always best to have a self-proving will. Therefore, you don't have to go through this step. And sometimes these things online are not self-proving wills. So that means that if it's not a self-proving will, the people have to locate one of the witnesses. And if you can't locate it, some of the surrogate's offices say, well, then you got to file a complaint, order show cause to admit the document to probate. Also, when people are doing things on their own, a lot of times they don't do it right. And remember, only the original will can be admitted to probate. A photocopy of the will cannot be admitted to probate. So, I tell people sometimes a photocopy of the will is just as valuable as a photocopy of a $20 bill you lost. You can't go to the bank and say, hey, I lost my 20. I need a copy of that. Now, who keeps the original will? Well, the original will is your property. So, in the old days, the attorneys would say they're going to keep it for, safety, but it was really so that people could try to get, represent the estate down the road. So, and there was a Supreme Court opinion that said that, again, wills are property of the client, and therefore, the attorney should only be keeping it if that's what the client specifically wants. And me, I don't want to be responsible for people's things anyway. So now, even though there's no registry of wills, there's no wills are taken home by the people. Where do you keep your original will? Well, it's best to keep it in a fireproof box under your bed, because typically the area under the bed goes to waste and you're never there. No one goes under the bed until the house is sold. Don't put it in a safe deposit box. Why? Well, let's say you can't get to it. Let's say if you had your will or documents in a safe deposit box, the bank's been closed for 2 months. Also, a lot of times banks get taken over. I'd say I was put on my dad's safe deposit box. One day I went to the box and the bank changed names, changed ownership, and they goes, oh, you're not on the account. He goes, no, listen, if my father went here, I know he filled out the papers, but they were just Wells Fargo sloppy and they just lost the papers. So now probate again in New Jersey is easy. let's say after someone passes, and so the surrogate's the name for the will clerk, we call it. Even while the surrogate's offices are closed, they're like, making, some modifications where we can fill out a form ahead of time. We email the form, then, we also email or fax a copy of the death certificate. We email or fax some other information. And then the surrogate looks it over and goes, okay, we will admit it to probate as soon as then we get the original will and original death certificate. So first we fax or email, and then the client sends by Federal Express or UPS to make sure that there's some tracking numbers, the original stuff. Then the surrogate will issue what's called letters testamentary, and that puts the executor in charge. We have to send out a notice of probate to everyone that would inherit where they're that's in the will. And then after the surrogate's out of the picture for most of it. So what are the next couple things that we do? Well, house gets listed for sale. Now there's no inheritance tax if assets are going to children, grandchildren, parents, but we still have to file an inheritance tax return. If it's going to brothers or sisters, the first $25,000 is tax-free. If it's going to charities, that money is free. Any other humans, though, it's taxed at 15%. Once the assets are liquidated and the inheritance tax division approves the return, then the executor will prepare an informal accounting. It's sent to all the beneficiaries, and with a form called the release and refunding bond. If all the beneficiaries sign the release for a funding bond, they get their money and the estate is over. Pretty easy. Other states, again, New York, California, very, 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 very complicated. Sometimes, though, in the will, trust. Most people in New Jersey don't need trust, but sometimes within a will, there's something called a testamentary trust. And that means it's not funded. But there could be grandchildren that the money's going to be held, for them. People with minor children oftentimes say they don't get their money until they're 22, 25, and 30. But someone is a family member becomes the trustee and puts the money into an account at Merrill Lynch, Morgan Stanley, make sure that their bills are paid, make sure that college is paid, sometimes buys a car. But we don't want to have minors, we don't want to have, like, let's say 20 year olds getting big chunks of money, because a 20 year old does not invest money wisely. So think about, people who do you want to be holding the money for your grandkid in the event you weren't around. And by the way, how are we signing documents now? Well, people either go to a notary at the UPS store, or my office, we're signing documents in the parking lot. We put up a table. We schedule signings once a week. That way, we just say, you sign here, here, here. We have witnesses in the parking lot. And then afterwards, we say, okay, have a seat in the car. We're going to make copies and bring it out to you. Hopefully, the crisis will be over by the time winter rolls around and it's cold again. So I mentioned wills are essential in New Jersey. Don't try to use one of these cheap forms online, because many times you won't do it correctly. The next document I'm going to talk about is powers of attorney. Let's see now. A will takes care of your assets if you pass away. What's a power of attorney? A power of attorney is a document while you are alive where you're giving the power to a family member or someone you trust to make sure that your bills are paid. They can sign your, they can pay your bills, access your accounts, etc. Now I also, say there was a change in the law on powers of attorney, where some of the banks weren't honoring good powers of attorney. They were trying to say, well, it wasn't done on our, you know, Wells Fargo form or Countrywide form. We're not going to honor it. So New Jersey legislature came up with a law to say, listen, if it makes reference to New Jersey statute, the bank or institution that does business in New Jersey had to honor it. However, it had to make reference to the New Jersey statute. It had to make reference to Section 2 of PL 1991, C95, C46:2B-11. And a lot, you know, I'm pretty sure these like cheaper free forms online don't mention reference to the New Jersey statute, and banks wouldn't honor. So the power of attorney typically gives the person you picked as your agent the ability to make sure if real estate needs to be sold, you know, real estate can be sold, you know, they can pay like any bills. Also, we added a clause like under the HIPAA statute that it authorizes them to talk to doctors and look at the medical records and have access, most importantly, to have access to, into bank accounts. Now, the power of attorney is effective either right away or only upon disability. Let's see. So most people, especially married people, make it effective right away. There's no need to, you know, so if it's effective right away, for example, it's called a durable power of attorney, stays into effect if you become incapacitated. A springing power of attorney is not effective until you become disabled and there's a certification by a doctor that you are incapacitated. But, you know, we had a client that said, Kenny, let's say I'm a carpenter. I don't understand durable and springing. Give it to me in carpenter terms. I'm a carpenter. He goes, okay. You know, number one, effective right away means your son can steal all your money right away. If it's effective only upon disability, your son would need a note from a doctor saying you're incapacitated, disabled before he steals your money. Knowing that, you trust your son. And the fellow said, I trust my son with my life. I goes, okay, then make it effective right away. So now, what we have been recommending people do recently, especially like, you know, while banks are closed, institutions are closed, we're trying to improve what we're doing for everyone, is after the documents are signed, scan them and forward them to every bank you do business with, forward them to the financial institutions. And am I back? Can you hear me, April?
Yes, you're back. I'm April's assistant. We can hear you.
Okay, I just want to make sure. Every once in a while, I worry that I'm just talking into a screen. You never know. All right. I'm always glad to help out the Woodbridge Library. Scanning is good.
Well, there's like a major outage right now.
Are we not on?
You cut out for a second, but now you're back in. So keep going.
All right, I'm keep going. So if anyone's writing stuff down, after you sign your power of attorney, have it scanned, send it to your kids, unless there's secret stuff you don't want them to know about. But that way it's there. You send it to instant, because it's easier to be able to help someone out and use it if, you know, the Merrill Lynch broker knows that you're there to, you know, help out mom, help out dad, or help out the brother, etc. Now, a will is valid forever. Sometimes you might want to make changes to it. You know, if the executor, you know, can no longer drive, no longer can get around. Our rule of thumb is someone should not be the executor if they can't walk up, five steps and they can't drive around. The same thing with the person you've picked in your power of attorney, because the whole idea is them to help you. you know, we like we love our spouse, we love our family, but if the person that we picked can't drive to the bank to do the job, then is there someone else who is can do it? Also, it's a good idea to re-sign the power of attorney every 5 years or so, especially if the person you picked has moved and has a different address, because occasionally, you know, someone could have a power of attorney that is prepared by your family's attorney, but then the daughter goes to the bank to try to help out mom, and the bank says, but there's a different name on this and a different address. And the daughter says, well, that's my maiden name, and I moved, to Monmouth County. Well, the banks are difficult to deal with when everything is fine. The bank is not going to honor a power of attorney right now if the person who's showing it on a screen has a different address, different ID, etc. So, look, if you have the power of attorney, look at it. And if you don't have a power of attorney, then you should get one done. And it's, you know, you give copies to the family. Okay, the last document we're going to talk about is the Living Will Advance Directive. People have heard of the Terry Schiavo case and the Karen Ann Quinlan case, where someone was on, you know, life support, and there's a battle amongst the family as to what to do. The idea of having these documents signed ahead of time is so that there's no battle amongst the family, so there's no hassle, there are no problems. And really, the living will isn't for you, it's for everyone else in the family. You know, so it's easy to think of the scenario where all of a sudden someone's, you know, at the end, they're in a coma, irreversible condition, they can't open up their eyes, they can't talk. And this way, you're giving instructions to hospitals and doctors ahead of time, hey, this is what I want, please respect my wishes. There was a time where a doctor said to me, because I had the power of attorney, but the person didn't get a living will done, and then the person's, you know, at the end, and the doctor basically says to me, like, okay, should we remove life support? And you know what the right call is for someone who's 92 years old that's never gonna, you know, regain consciousness, but you hate to be the one to say, okay, doctor, let's end it today. You feel bad. You know, I couldn't even do it on my dog. You know, when my old dog was like, you know, so sick, and we were spending thousands of dollars with the vet, but I still could not be the one to say, okay, today's gonna be the dog's last day. So in the Living Will Advance Directive, and by the way, if anyone has any questions, our Woodbridge Library has a chat button, because we're only supposed to go until about 7:45 or so. Anyway, the Living Will, the first section, there's an area that asks questions on fluids and nutrition. So typically, most people, probably 80% now, say, hey, listen, if there's no hope for me, I don't want to be on feeding tubes and things like that. But it's someone's decision on what to do. Now, some people were scared, saying, well, does this mean that, you know, I wouldn't be, if I had a heart attack, nothing would be done? No, they're always, you know, if you're at home or you're at ShopRite, of course they're going to, like, you know, do their best to, you know, put you in the ambulance, bring you to the hospital, etc. You know, but, you know, let's say someone has some kind of, like, you know, terminal condition, and like the doctor says, okay, like, you know, they got a week to go. The priest is given the last rites. You can give these instructions to the doctor, saying, listen, I don't want to be on feeding tubes. The next section of Living Will deals with what we call like a medical treatment and artificial means. You know, so 99% of people say, if there's no hope for me, I don't want to be kept alive if my body is gone. Yeah. Again, there's difference between someone all of a sudden goes to the hospital and the doctor says, hey, we got to get this person on a ventilator. Hey, that's fine. You know, but on the other hand, you know, someone who's like, you know, 96 years old and they also have, you know, leukemia, they got MS and the doc, you know, the doctor says, this is the last week. Well, so, but it's an important document to have. You know, ironically, when I was first getting married 30 years ago, my wife said, oh, if something happened to you, I could never let them pull the plug. So I said, okay, fine. I'll just leave my dad because he's logical like Mr. Spock. So then you go like 25, 30 years in the future, my wife would be instead saying, so, okay, if he passes, I get $800,000 of life insurance tax-free. Okay, there's different things that people think about when you're been married 30 years. We revised our medical forms, our living will forms, to have a HIPAA authorization. So you're authorizing your medical power of attorney to be able to talk to doctors. And the last page of the living will advance directive to ask questions about organ donors. Yes or no. And I like to explain to my clients that I went to an interesting program put on by the NJ Sharing Network. That's the entity in New Jersey that facilitates organ donation. I asked the question, yeah, raise your hand. He asked the question. You know, I said, what is the maximum age to be an organ donor? And they said, there is no maximum age. So I said, well, what's good on an 85-year-old guy? And they said, like, you know, cornea and skin. I goes, well, I never thought about that. You know, if I was going blind, I'd rather have old guys' eyes. If I was in a bad fire, I'd rather have old guy's skin than the stuff that got burned off me. And I also asked the question, I go, what diseases disqualify someone from being an organ donor? Because, you know, to be a blood donor, the list of disqualifiers is 18 pages long. But at the time, they said the only disqualifier to be an organ donor was HIV. And ironically, a year ago, they took that away. Someone with HIV can be an organ donor to someone else that has HIV. So, you know, let's say if someone needed a kidney transplant, you know, their partner could say, hey, listen, let's say you need a kidney. I got two. You can have one of mine. You know, I have HIV. You have HIV. But, you know, I'd say, yeah, you can have one of my kidneys. Now, the living will, you should give copies of the living will to your family. You should give copies to your doctor. So it's also a good idea to scan your living will, and that way you have it. I scanned my living will, and I sent it to myself on an email. This way, I could be like at a traffic light, and I could look up the email on my cell phone where I sent myself my living will, and I have it there. I'd say, yeah, and that's something smart to do. I also emailed me my insurance card for my car in case I can't find it. I even emailed my American Legion card and my Elks card, so if I'm ever at a place and I need to prove I'm still a member, at least I have a scanned copy on my phone. So we've covered four main topics. I covered wills, I covered probate, covered power of attorney, we covered living will, and I also cover a little bit about trusts. Most people in New Jersey don't need to have a trust because the the probate law is easy, and there's no New Jersey in estate tax. Some people, though, their trust does benefit. If it's a second marriage situation, you don't want to give everything to your second spouse, hoping that they'll share it with your family. Some people set up trusts where it's called an irrevocable trust, and that's to shield assets in the event you have to go into a nursing home. But an irrevocable Medicaid trust it's a 5-year look back period. And I see that we are now past 7:45. So I thank the people that were paying attention. Does the Woodbridge Library have any comments or any questions you want to ask me? I see that there is a question in our chat, so I will look at that. Let's say, yeah. If someone is getting a house in a will, there needs to be a new deed. Just like if someone got divorced and in the divorce decree, it says they get the house. Well, that's only an agreement between their ex and that court system. Until there's a new deed filed with the county clerk's office, there is no record that of who owns the house. So when property is transferred, there's a deed, affidavit of title, seller's residency certification, affidavit of exemption because you don't have to pay the taxes, and there's also a cover sheet, and the filing fee with the county clerk is about $150. Also it has to reference the lot and block. It has to reference when someone became the executor. But make sure you do it now. Just yesterday, someone called me up and they said, mom inherited the house from her mom. When her mom died 5 years ago, but she never did anything. And now mom herself is in the hospital. I goes, well, that's a problem because mom can no longer act as the executor. And we're going to have a substitute executor put in to do all work on transferring the assets. Okay, Woodbridge Library, any other questions?
Does anybody have any other questions they'd like to ask in the chat?